Good afternoon. We start with tragic breaking news. A fourth resident of the Newmarch House nursing home who contracted coronavirus has died. The 79-year-old woman was suffering from multiple health issues and her cause of death is still yet to be determined. It comes after another resident and a staff member at the facility tested positive for the infection, bringing the overall total number of cases there to 44. Well, we are standing by for breaking news this afternoon on the Ruby Princess. 5 weeks after it first arrived in Sydney and was linked to 21 deaths and more than 900 coronavirus infections, the cruise ship is about to leave Australian waters. These are live pictures coming into our newsroom from Port Kembla, where it's been docked for the last 2 weeks, and we've seen the slow removal of the crew on board. As late as today, crew members were still being removed. We have our reporters on the ground. The information they are getting is that it's about to set sail any moment there, so we'll cross to those reporters as soon as that happens. Well, the driver who fled the scene of the deadly Melbourne crash that killed four police officers has now handed himself in as the names of the victims are revealed, and we'll have more on that story, that tragic story, coming out very shortly. Well, hundreds of thousands of Australians are seeking to access their superannuation early. We'll go live to our political reporter Fiona Willen in Canberra. Fee, good afternoon to you. The government has confirmed an overwhelming response today.
Tabina, we've heard a lot of big numbers today, and of course that means that a lot of people are really needing money right now. So the Prime Minister and the Treasurer have provided an update on the economic support measures to help Australians through the pandemic. Now, one of the more controversial plans was the decision to allow some Australians to access their super early. Now, today we have learned more than 450,000 people have applied to do that. So that's worth $3.8 billion so far. The average withdrawal is around $8,000. We've also received an update on those $750 cash payments for pensioners and income support recipients. So those payments have now been made to 6.8 million people, totaling $5.1 billion. Also, there's a development with the JobKeeper scheme. Now, these are the payments of $1,500 per fortnight to help employers keep paying their staff. Let's hear from the Treasurer.
More than 900,000 Australian businesses have registered their interest in accessing the JobKeeper payment. The formal applications have been open for 3 days. Already, 275,000 businesses have filled in those formal applications for the JobKeeper payment.
Now, Josh Frydenberg has held a phone hookup with the big four banks to deal with a problem that's emerged from the JobKeeper program. So under the scheme, businesses are required to pay their staff and then they'll get paid back from the first week of May. But some employers haven't got the money to do that. So the banks have agreed to provide better support in the meantime and set up hotlines for customers who need help. Today, the conversation has also turned to Australia's borders and how long they'll remain closed. This is what the Prime Minister had to say.
If there is any country in the world with whom we can reconnect with first, undoubtedly that's New Zealand. We have similar trajectories.
But don't go booking a trip to New Zealand just yet. The Chief Medical Officer has also warned that it's unlikely there'll be changes to international travel over the next 3 or 4 months.
Okay, Fiona, we'll leave it there. Thank you. Well, there have been just 5 new cases of infection in New South Wales after nearly 6,000 people were tested for coronavirus in the last 24 hours. 2 of those patients include a paramedic based at Liverpool in the city's southwest and a nurse working at Sydney Adventist Hospital at Warunga on the Upper North Shore.
It's probably one of the best results we've had given the number of people tested and the low number of cases. So we know that these restrictions we've had in place are working, and I deeply want to thank everybody for their persistence, your vigilance, your patience. And I know how frustrating it's been, but we're also deeply grateful that everybody has done the right thing.
The total number of cases in New South Wales now sits at 2,976. Well, now to Europe and our correspondent Ben Avery for the latest on the staggering virus death toll gripping the UK.
Well, the UK government's official death toll currently stands at 18,100, but analysis that's been done by the Financial Times newspaper has that figure at more like 41,000 when you take into account the deaths that have happened outside of hospitals. And if that is the case, if the figure is around 40,000, then indeed the UK is the worst affected country in Europe as a result of the coronavirus outbreak. Certainly earlier on today, the Health Minister Matt Hancock said that the country is now in the peak of the pandemic. He said that that does come with some better news in that hospitals are starting to clear out to an extent. There's now up to 10,000 spare beds across the country, and the National Health Service will now be allowed to start opening again for those routine surgeries that were put on hold when this outbreak first began. So there is some light at the end of the tunnel now, but the people of the UK have been told they're not out of the woods just yet. The chief medical officer said, look, this virus is here to stay for some time. It's not going to go away quickly. And he expects that some of those lockdown measures will remain in place for many months, possibly up to a year.
A 33-year-old man has been arrested following an extensive investigation into three armed robberies across Sydney's inner west earlier this year. It's alleged the man stole cash and threatened staff with a machete at three businesses. He's facing court today. A man's been found suffering critical head injuries at Surrey Hills. Emergency services were called to a unit on Elizabeth Street just after midnight, where they found the man believed to be in his 50s. He was treated at the scene and taken to St Vincent's Hospital in a critical condition.